politics, not how to make a deal. I'm not Steve Harvey trying to sell people cars. Well, that was very interesting. We have about 15 minutes left. Well, so we can at least begin to delve into the conversation regarding why the need for a new ministerial organization here in the city of Boston. But before we go there, I have to ask you, do you have a broadcast tonight?
I don't.
Okay, so this is your first free night. Okay, so we'll probably end this broadcast, and it'll take me an hour to clean off that desk, and we'll still be here at the same time. Well, as you know, we are, and for those of you who are listening, we are going to start a brand new ministerial organization called Boston Black Ministers United for Change. I like that title. It's nice. Flowing off of me. Boston is important to say that we are from Boston. Black talks about who we are. Ministers is vocation. United, because everybody says that we have too much brokenness, fraction in among the clergy. And we're talking about being united. Let's unite. And one of the ideas and concepts that we had about this new ministerial association is that we were not going to incorporate and we were not going to seek funding to run the organization because, in my opinion, this organization can be run without any money. Mm-hmm. We can use social media. Mm-hmm. We can use emails. We can use the radio and TV network and still communicate effectively and mobilize people. And what we plan to do, unlike other ministerial associations, and there are many, there are denominational associations, there are nonprofit associations, there are praying ministerial associations, there are all types. So what we're basically saying is that we want to be a more aggressive organization that's able to address some of the major issues in our city without having to worry about where our money is coming from or whether or not money will no longer flow into our organization because we took a stand on an issue. We don't want to be concerned about losing our nonprofit status. So we're developing a totally different concept in developing an organization that's going to be aggressive in addressing these issues, number one. Number two, the other thing I wanted us to do was to consider having a monthly rally here at the church from 5 to 6 so that we can air a rally at Global Ministries Christian Church from 5 to 6 on one Sunday a month and invite people into the church as we talk to them about the issues that we've been addressing and hear from the community as to those things that need to be addressed by the clergy. So that's kind of where, that's as far as it's been developed in my mind. Again, we have other clergy groups, mm-hmm. but to the best of my knowledge, I don't know why I'm yawning so much, so, and I'm not tired. To the best of my knowledge, I do not know why most of the other ministerial groups in the city are not publicly addressing major issues, whether they be political issues or issues in the community. I don't hear of them addressing the issues.
Absolutely not. I you're right. I mean, it's just true. I mean, and as I think about even historically about movements, and you know, the voice of the church is to be prophetic, right? Not to be responsive, you know, to the status quo and reactionary, but prophetic, ahead of. I mean, this vehicle, it just amazes me again. This with the Boston Praise Radio and TV Network, just having seen the exponential growth as God has given you the vision and then the provision for this step by step. As you talk about the tortoise and the hare, you know, I see that, and I mean, it's comical to me. It really is how entities have come, you know, and they've fallen. You know, when you see the prosperity of the wicked, your foot can almost slip because though it may seem to be blowing up, if it's not built, it's going to come crashing down. And even entities that have, you know, I mean, there is, we talk about even the AM affiliate station, point blank, you know, the reality is I'll never forget you going to the entity talking when we're leasing a large portion of the time on this signal, and then the rents go up and the rates go up, and then but you stood your ground and said, no, I'm going to pull all of my resources from investing into this vehicle that's now trying to exploit me to be able to put it into building what God's given you. And we're told, oh, you don't want the headache. It's too much trouble. You know, why would you want to do that? You can continue to be, you know, put money into this vehicle, and you trusted God. And now that same vehicle is shut down, and we're a year in and continuing to grow exponentially. So I say that to say that's the same thing as it really, and so it won't be bought. Where other entities, we've had entities, you know, like BET, Black Entertainment Television, you know, entities that, networks that people have said that people bought into the concept of this is by us, for us, but ultimately money was the thing that actually had them to sell their voice. And as I look at the abolitionist movement, the civil rights movement, these were things that were not funded by federal programs that then mute your potency. And so that's been the consistent pattern, is if you believe God, God gives you a vision and he gives you provision for that vision, that you're not going to be able to be beholding to these entities that may give you resources, but then mute your voice and your potency.
And I think it's important that we maintain our integrity, mm-hmm. that when God speaks to us, we don't put our finger in the air and try to determine which way the wind is blowing and then make a decision based on what's going to be safe. And I think that's another thing, is that a lot of these ministerial organizations cannot even get consensus to go ahead and move forward to address a critical issue in our community. And so this new organization is going to be, right now it's starting out with about five of us, and there have been some clergy who have asked to be a part of it.
Oh, I'm so sure that's going to happen. I saw this notion of, you know, testing it, and I agree, because there's always going to be the infiltrators, and I'm sure that happened during the abolitionist movement, the civil rights movement. And so how do you be able to stop the spies? And we've had some opportunities before that, you know, people were in, and then when people come to even to you and have tried to use your integrity, your character, your reputation, and your genuine concern for the community to then, you know, encourage you to do something that then they're behind the scenes and, you know, doing manipulating, and then when, you know, the bottom falls out, everybody scatters and leaves you there to then be able to try to pick up the pieces.
That's why I've got to lead the drive. I've got to lead the momentum and choose people that I have a like mind and passion and mission.
Yeah.
And we have to agree. And I think the way that we're trying to do it here as pastors in the church is the way that we need to do it on the outside.
Yep. Yeah.
And we lead by agreement and consensus, and we don't lead based on what other people say we should or shouldn't.
You know, it's
do.
True. What I think about, Pastor, is the Gideon concept. You know, it's not, I mean, God can do it by many or few. You know, in the Gideon concept, really, we understand that there were too many people. And so the people who lapped water like a dog, you know, folks who were focused, you know, and so folks, and the power of agreement. So one is your motivation, your intent, and the other piece is unity, right? So one can put 1,000, two can put 10,000. So, and a house divided amongst itself cannot stand. How can two walk together unless they agree? So those are principles of one, your motivation, to the unity. And so with that, I think, you know, we have what we need to be able to do. And, you know, the Bible says, know those who labor amongst you. And behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. I'm hearing, quite candidly, it's really disheartening. I'm hearing from, you know, social media and so forth, of denominations big, huge religious denominations that are, you know, attacking each other, leadership amongst each other, throwing each other under the bus, lawsuits, you know, all these different kind of things is going on under the guise of church. And the Bible clearly says, you know, that you shouldn't take a brother to court. And they're like, well, they're not a brother because of the accusations. And I mean, it's just crazy. So it's not about quantity. These huge denominations, right? But now they're crumbling because of these principles that are not being adhered to.
Well, Mary Curry is asking us some questions. And one of the questions, one of the things that she said, so it would be a different kind of an NAACP. Good idea on the cat, Pastor Bruce, or CAT, Pastor Bruce. I don't know what the cat means. And then she says, you always need money. While the wind, good point. So when I say money,
yeah,
I think a lot of organizations raise money because they want to hire staff. They want to receive money to compensate themselves and everybody else who's a part of the organization. They need money for transportation. They need money to live. Well, I think that when you do that,
yep,
you begin to pursue the money for those reasons. And then you have to realize that when you address major, major issues, for example, a guy like Reverend Al Sharpton, he cannot depend upon the city, the state, to give him money for his organization because those are the people he's attacking.
Right.
He has to raise money through his radio and television programs and selling ads on he has a radio and television program that is on many different AM and FM radio stations across the country.
Mm-hmm.
He sells ads, and that money and revenue that comes in is based on how popular he is or is not, and that's how he survives.
Mm-hmm.
We need to find a similar way to bring revenue in that's not necessarily based on grants or nonprofit status. And, for example, at this point in time, I don't need a salary from a new ministerial organization because I work two jobs. And so right now I don't need that. And most of the people who are joining the organization have other means to at least survive. And so my thought is we need an organization that's going to hit the ground running very quickly, address some major issues in the city. And by addressing these issues or winning some of these issues, they immediately develop a reputation that has other people recognizing who they are, and other people will help to shape the agenda for what issues we need to address. And I see an organization like this identifying four major issues each year. And they say, these are the things that we're going to sink our teeth in. But we're not going to stay at the grind. We're not going to stay at this 24/7. It's going to be like Superman, that you go and address the issue, and when it's over, you become Clark Kent. In essence, you breathe. You don't walk 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, looking for issues to address and burn and tire yourself out. Identify some core issues, address them, and rest. That's kind of what I like to do. And when we talk about, are we going to be like an NAACP, I hope not. Because right now, although our NAACP in recent months and years has been addressing some issues, I think until the NAACP and the Urban League embrace Mamlio, and the fact that Mamlio has taken the city and the police commissioner, the police department, to court for injustices and have won the cases in the appeals court, then I think that these other black civil rights organizations need to come around Mamlio, because if they came around Mamlio and went to the powers that be and said, you are going to settle these cases with Mamlio, I think we would have less and less and less issues coming from City Hall, our police department, and our state government. For example, Governor Baker is supporting lifting the cap on the charter schools.
Right.
And he's doing a major ad about it.
Yes.
But it's impacting us more than it's impacting a lot of the suburban mm-hmm. schools. Mm-hmm. So my concern is, why is he weighing in at all? Mm-hmm. Why would he get involved in this? Mm-hmm. There's no, his kids, to the best of my knowledge, never went to a charter school. And the suburban folk that he's playing to, I just don't get it. I don't understand what he's doing. And so if our ministerial group was up and going, mm-hmm. we would ask him that question. Mm-hmm. The Boston Black Ministers United for Change want to ask the governor why he's supporting lifting the cap on the charter school, and does he understand the impact of how that's going to impact the Boston public schools here in our city. So that's one of the issues that we could address. 617-282-0685. It's 11 o'clock. We need to go to station ID, and then we'll come back with more discussion for the next hour right here on the Boston Praise Radio and TV Network. And when Pastor Hubbard is ready, he'll give me the sign. I'll stop talking, and then we'll go to our station identification right here on the Boston Praise Radio and TV Network. And I think, unfortunately, that means
WRCA 1330 AM radio and WBPG 102.9 FM radio.
I can go to mine.
The voice of the church in New England.
Show off.
The views and opinions expressed by the following paid program are those of the program producers, and they do not reflect the views and opinion of Boston Praise Radio, its staff, or management.
Hi, I'm Minister Franklin Hobbs, and I'm inviting you to join us on Healing Our Lands live broadcast heard on the Boston Praise Radio Network Monday through Friday, 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Be blessed.
You can listen to Boston Praise Radio and TV on audio now. Just dial 712-432-4402. That's 712-432-4402. You will be able to hear us right on your cell phone without any software. That's audio now, and dial 712-432-4402.
Hi, this is Mike D of the UA7 Gospel Countdown, Urban America's 7 biggest current songs and more. Join us in fellowship with our broadcast on www.bostonpraiseradio.tv, Roku TV, WRCA 1330 AM radio, and WBPG 102.9 FM radio. These TV and radio networks are all coming out of Boston. Radio and TV that cares about Boston and beyond. This is yours sincerely, Mike D. of the UA7 Gospel Countdown. Tune in and be blessed.
If you want to broadcast on the Boston Praise Radio and TV Network, please call us at 617-282-0685. That's 617-282-0685. You can broadcast on the internet, Roku TV, or our brand new station, WBPG-LP 102.9 FM radio. Again, call us at 617-282-0685. 617-282-0685.
The Worship Tour. We are here. Featuring Grammy, Billboard, and Stellar Award artist Travis Green, Jonathan McReynolds, and Anthony Brown and Group Therapy. March 2nd at Orpheum Theater. Tickets on sale now at Ticketmaster.com. The hottest names in gospel, Travis Green, Jonathan McReynolds, and Anthony Brown and Group Therapy.
That commercial ends. It just ends so abruptly, doesn't it? So I need to find a way to redo that and allow it to actually fade out. We need to go to one more announcement here on the Boston Praise Radio and TV Network. So let's go there and see.
This is Pastor Bruce Wall. Join Ron Bell,
Pastor Franklin Hobbs, Minister Priscilla Flint Banks, Brother Lowe, and many, many more as we host the Get Out the Vote rally on Monday, November 7th, 2016 at the Global Ministries Christian Church located at 670 Washington Street in Dorchester, Mass., zip code 02124. Remember, a man cannot ride your back unless it's bent. It is time that we straighten out our backs. I will see you on the 7th of November at the Global Ministries Christian Church, 670 Washington Street, Dorchester, Mass., zip code 02124. For more information about the rally, call 617-282-0685. That's 617-282-0685. Well, that ended a little bit better. That's because we put it together. 617-282-0685. Do you think, do you feel that we should have a new ministerial organization here in the city of Boston? Or are you satisfied with the role of the pastors who are involved in the denominational ministerial associations and some of the nonprofit associations? Mary Alice Curry is talking with us, and I'm looking at some of what she's saying as well. That, oh, I'm sorry, I meant what you said. Great idea. Wow. So the idea that's being floated is the idea about starting a new ministerial group in the city of Boston. Some of the present ministerial groups are intentional about choosing what issues they do or do not address. And unfortunately, when they do not address major issues in our town, it allows those who are creating problems for us to be able to continue to create these problems without any concern about being challenged by any of us, any ministerial association. It's amazing, the ministerial associations would march on you or march on your business or march on City Hall. And we haven't seen that. We've seen in Boston the ministerial associations march to support the very people who are oppressing us and the very people who won't hire us and the very people who keep taking us back to court after Mamlio has taken the city police and the mayor to court. What happens, and Mamlio is winning, the city says we're going to appeal to the next judicial authority. And that really bothers me because it doesn't really show that the city is willing to settle so that Mamlio will not have to continue this battle and spend all of this money on cases that they're winning and the city is losing. I just do not know why the city feels that they have to keep attacking and keep pushing Mamlio away from the table. And so that's why we need this new ministerial organizations. And again, you don't need 35, 40, 50 people. All you need is five people who are willing to work with and speak with one voice. Do you agree?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, again, it's not about quantity, but quality, and being unified with one vision. I mean, we know, again, I keep going to the Gideon concept, and or I would say, you know, the Tower of Babel or the Day of Pentecost. Those are, you know, three specific times that I can see that the principle of unity, and with the Gideon, it specifically speaks about it being a small number. I don't think it's at all about the number. Because again, if we get quantity with folks who have hidden agendas, they're different places, then it dilutes the potency of it being small but tight and unified and consistent.
617-282-0685. If you're still with us, if you're still awake, we would like to hear, Pastor Hobbs and I would like to hear your comments. Do we need another ministerial association in Boston? Do you think that our ministerial associations have virtually
Praise Radio and TV Network
addressed the issues, but they've been addressing safe issues, and they're not issues where they're actually willing to go on the line, step over the line, and really address issues that are going to help to change Boston. 617-282-0685 is our number, and I'm hoping that you will accept the challenge to pick up the phone at 11:09 p.m. and talk with Pastor Hobbs and I about these concerns. They're major, major concerns. What are we going to do about having a ministerial association that is willing to go and address these issues? And we're going to go to the phone line right now, and we're going to speak to somebody who has their radio on or their computer on. Make sure you turn your computer or radio down so we don't have the feedback. My suggestion,
I think it might be my TV.
Right. Listen to us and not the TV or radio, because it will delay you responding to us.
Okay. I was spending time with you all, and I gave up my criminal mind, so
all right.
And I ignored the TV.
Thank you.
And so, I mean, even though we were talking about cars, I said I kind of swore the heading said political something, but it was nice to see Pastor Bruce with a good sense of humor. It had me laughing. I'm like, oh my gosh. I don't know if I'm supposed to be laughing, but he's like serious. So, you know, I have participated in the Black Ministerial Alliance on Facebook, and then they said, if you don't respond by such and such a time, you will be taken off of the group.
Yep, me too.
From Facebook.
Me too.
From Facebook. Because you got to pay
a certain amount
of money. And it was like, are you serious? Like,
I never thought about that. It's true.
Yeah. We don't see them doing anything, and it didn't hit me until he said something. I really don't see them doing something unless they're standing, excuse my French, but you're standing behind this white man who's talking about what they're doing in the community, when I don't even see you all doing anything in the community besides making sure you're on TV. And I agree with Pastor Bruce, like, having somebody say, okay, I was totally shocked when I seen the governor on TV and said, you know, we need to go for and say yes on question two. Mm-hmm. When I, like, there's two different stories, and you know, my mom said, well, the governor said yes, and the wife said no. I said, you mean to tell me, I didn't know the governor and the mayor can go against each other. I thought they were supposed to be on the same page. But, you know, to have some ministers, some clergy, and I'm not going to take it as that you mean just all men, because God do use women as clergy, but we need some people, like you said, that's not going to be afraid to speak up to the governor or the mayor or NAACP or, you know, other groups. And when I was saying similar to NAACP, it's like, you know, speaking up for the community.
Mm. Right.
You know, speaking up for the things that's going on and what they're not doing.
Right. And I'm struggling because I'm trying very hard not to criticize any of these ministerial associations that are in Boston. And I think just because we raised the fact that we need a new ministerial organization, it actually sounds like that's what Pastor Hobbs and I are doing. But I'm trying very hard to land the plane and be very soft as it relates to raising these issues. But I don't see any ministerial group, if anything, the last major thing that the ministers did in this town is that they had a rally to support the police department when around the country people were having rallies against the police department. So in Boston, a group of ministers got together, they had a rally to support the police department, and at the same rally with a lot of the white officers out there, they attacked Black Lives Matter. And I said to myself, why would you do something like that? And then I found out that a number of those clergy are receiving stipend or money from the police department and the mayor. So it makes me feel like I can't even trust certain preachers if they're being paid to do these things to support the city and support the police department, correct?
I mean, you have a good point, and you have to remember, you're a pastor, and you've been a pastor for a long time. I've been to your church. I've gotten a computer and had got training for computer and was able to go there and use computers. But the thing is, the Bible says, the word says, expose the devil. And that, you know, we can't just be touching and agreeing just because they look a certain way, you know, doesn't mean that we touch and agree with them. Because if you're going to step on your people to get to a certain place, I know for sure, I lived in South Boston, Comcast is prejudiced, the police is prejudiced, and the people out there are prejudiced. I lived with my daughter. I've seen spirits, like Caucasian woman, wanting us to get out the house. And I'm like, these people really don't want you here. That spirit, Irish, or whatever they want to call it, German, Russian, those folks were the ones that was here and had us as slaves. They're some of the first ones to have us as slaves. But it was the Black people, the Africans, that helped them capture other Africans to have as slaves. So if we continue to do that, this is 2016. And if we're still going to allow ourselves to be slaves, then it doesn't make sense to put anything together. But myself, I'm more than willing to be an intercessor for this new program you're going to have. We need people who are going to move, you know, like you're going to do stuff. We don't need to continue to have a program with paperwork from 2009 that you haven't addressed yet, or 2013. This is 2016. People are fussing back and forth about Donald Trump, Hillary. Okay, the emails are coming from somewhere, but they're not coming from Hillary. If they said she's okay, let's move forward. We know that Donald Trump, whether he be orange, green, purple, or white, this man does not care about us. And so to have five people, five is the number of grace, it's the number for the fivefold ministry. You have been a strong, Black, powerful man. I know in that neighborhood where there's shootings, stabbings, you helped me to be comfortable with walking down Washington Street to go to your church or to the library. And so, as Pastor Franklin Hobbs said, the Lord told Gideon, I don't want you to use 10,000 people. Mm-hmm. See, that ministerial group, they were collecting people on Facebook. You didn't kick in no money, then you get the boot. But as you said, like, it made me think, like, what do they be doing? How come I don't see them? What about when they had the issue at Boston Latin? I don't remember them speaking. I don't remember seeing them on any news speaking about anything.
You know, a group of us got together this summer, and we called for a state of emergency regarding the homicides in Boston. And it was a small group of us, there were maybe 10 of us, who stood in this station, and I had some clergy who were with me, but some of the clergy who were with me are some of the same clergy who broadcast on this radio station. But we didn't. The mayor stood up the same day and said, we don't have a state of emergency regarding people being killed in the city. We don't. And the mayor basically said the answer, he told me the answer to the homicides in Boston is him and some of the black clergy and the police commissioner walking through the neighborhood with the press following them. And I said, Mr. Mayor, that's the answer? That's all you think we need to do is to walk through the neighborhoods with you and the police commissioner? And they spent $80,000 or $90,000 to buy an ice cream truck, and they were driving around the black community giving out ice cream to children. So that's the total investment of the city that we pay taxes to, is an ice cream truck and for them to walk around the neighborhood. While in South Boston, they're pouring millions of dollars into South Boston to build up the seaport. They're pouring millions of dollars into the South End to build up the South End and the lower part of Roxbury. But what we get is an ice cream truck and the police commissioner walking around with these clergy. Is something wrong with that?
Yes, you have to remember, I was in Pine Street. Pine Street was not made for us. Pine Street was made for the Irish people, for Caucasian people. They have detectives, police officers, whatever they want to use, including the black ones, to pretend that there's somebody else in the neighborhood so they can catch the drug dealers. You know, they're arresting people for marijuana, but they'll let a child molester go and continue to roam the street when he just got busted in his car showing himself to girls on the bus. But one, their priorities are not organized. Two, they really don't care about us. They care about us messing up their neighborhoods, but they will let, if you go to Andrews Station, Mass Ave in Albany, you will see majority Caucasian people on dope. And they are not making no major issue to clean that area up. If there had been a whole bunch of blacks, somebody got stabbed out there tonight. There was a shooting, I believe, yesterday from what I was told. But if it was a bunch of black people out there, Spanish, they would be working their butts off to have them moved. But when it's their own color, you can go sit in Andrew Station and see the people who are dealing with dope. I'm taking pain medication. The hospital wants to take me through some changes about the medicine. And it's like, why are you taking me through changes when it's the people who are on this stuff and abusing it? They come in here nodding and wobbling and carrying on, and you're still giving them the medicine, but you want to take me through some changes. It's not my fault.
Well, let me ask you one more question. I got to clear the line because I got other people who want to call. How did you find us, by the way?
Facebook. I've been following you and Pastor Franklin for some years now, so...
Well,
you all will not be able to get rid of me.
Well, I appreciate the fact that you are listening, and I really appreciate hearing your comments. We're going to clear the line because more people want to call in. God bless you.
Okay, bless you.
Okay, thank you. 617-282-0685. Do we need a new ministerial organization in the city of Boston? Is it time for a new group of men and women to step forward and address these issues? Pastor Hobbs?
I mean, to me, that's a rhetorical question. I mean, the answer, I mean, I hope that people would weigh in and give their perspective. But the bottom line, they say insanity is doing the same thing and expecting a different result. Clearly, we can see what's happening in our community is not effective. I mean, so, you know, so something more needs to be done above and beyond what is already happening. That's just a given. And so it's imperative that we don't just complain. It's easy to say what people are not doing and what should be happening and point the finger and complain. What's more difficult to do is to roll up your sleeves and do something different that we can to be able to make some difference.
So Mary Curry said, yes, we need a new organization if we're going to move. Mm-hmm. So she's saying there's no need to have a new organization.
That's true.
If all we're going to do the same thing that they do.
Absolutely.
And that's basically focus on internal things. And again, there are some ministerial groups that are doing good work in the context of what they've defined as
work. That's right.
But we need a more aggressive, because in my opinion, I believe that the ministerial groups need to be on the front line on a number of the issues, not all of them, but on a number of the issues, they need to be on the front line. I believe that the movement for change need to be coming from the people of faith, the people who believe in God through the person of Jesus Christ. All I have in my mind, and maybe my generation is part of the problem, but what I have in my mind is thinking about the civil rights struggle and how people would meet in the black church and pray and rally because they knew that when they left that church to go out and march the next day or that same day, that there were dogs that were going to bite them. There were hoses that were going to wet them down and hose them down and tear off their clothes. They were going to be hit with billy clubs, and they needed to pray. And the other unique thing is that they were taught how to march. They were taught how to resist. And I'm hearing today a lot of folks are saying, if we were to walk into something like that today, we're not going to resist. We're not turning the other cheek. People are saying they're going to retaliate. There are black people who are preparing themselves for a race war, and they said they're going to be as aggressive as those who come against them. So it's a whole different flavor, especially with a generation of men and women who are not churched, who have not been touched by the power of God, who are not walking as men and women with a relationship with Christ. Although I know that there are men and women who are walking with a relationship with Christ who are saying they're not turning their cheek this time. So, I mean, what are we going to do? We don't have the type of leader in our country that could speak and capture the attention of the entire world. We don't have anybody like that, any black person that I know of. Even our president, although as respected a man as he is, and I respect him, there are a lot of people who are saying they don't feel that he's done enough to help black people. So even his call, and many times maybe the issue is that the president, being the president for everybody, had to temper his call, because he could not sound like he was being one-sided, that he was only speaking to black people. So it had to he watered down a lot of the things that he said and a lot of the things that we wanted to do him to do. He did not do. He could not do. So we don't have that voice. And what are we going to do without that voice? Many people are saying we should not look for a single voice to address these issues, because they can always attack and take that single voice out. So we shouldn't be looking for a savior, a Moses, a Jesus. We shouldn't be looking for a Jeremiah. Caller, you go ahead. You are live on the air.
Hey, Pastor Wall. Much respect. This is Richard Eric White. I always listen to you. I've been, you know, you guys helped me out of a terrible situation. But I just want to chime in for the young brothers that are 35 and under.
Okay, go.
Excuse me?
Yeah, go ahead, go. That's good.
Because that's what I have seen, and that's what I've dealt with in my life. I'm talking about 18 to 35. Mm-hmm. And these brothers are very unconscious. Yep. They're unaware. A lot of them are uneducated. But the hip-hop music has influenced them. influenced by Jay-Z. They are influenced by Young Jeezy. They are influenced by who Jimmy Iovine, which was John Lennon's sound engineer, who signed Niggas with an Attitude, which made the N-word prevalent in our music. Mm-hmm. Okay? So see, all of this stuff has been whitewashed. Mm-hmm. And people are ignoring it. They're scared to step up to it. And there's a generation coming up that wants to learn.
Yeah.
And they're going to either go one way or the other. And this is our opportunity to approach them. A lot of them are locked up. They will be coming home. A lot of them are in college. A lot of them are in a progressive field. But they are being influenced by hip-hop and rap. And I'm just here to say that that is influencing them to disrespect women, to go out here, grab a gun, kill their brother, walk around with their pants down, say the N-word, traumatize their own community, and we definitely need to put people in position like yourself, Boston Praise Radio, Healing Our Lands Ministry, to have a revival. We may need to get out in the street like they do on the Caribbean Day Festival,
yes,
and have a revival in the street and let these young kids know that there are people ready to raise their level of awareness. And I'm not going to hold your time. I'm going
to
No.
I want you to stay. I want you to stay because it's good to hear your perspective, because you could bring something to the discussion. Mm-hmm. And we have no idea how many people are or are not listening to us. So, and hopefully we are recording this so that we could re-air this on our FM station. So I said to Pastor Hobbs while you were calling in that people are saying we should not look for one person, a savior, a messiah, a person, mm-hmm, to rescue us, mm-hmm, or to speak to us, that it's that these voices are going to come from many different corners. Do you think that that's true or not true?
I think that what you've done with Boston Praise Radio, what you're doing with Facebook, which I just did a Google search, Facebook is the number one social networking site in the world. Wow. It has more users than Instagram, LinkedIn, Pinterest, Google. Everyone is on Facebook. There are going to be people that are listening to this in Australia, in, mm-hmm, Washington, D.C., mm-hmm, all over. So I think that they killed Martin.
Mm-hmm.
They killed Malcolm.
Mm-hmm.
They killed Tupac.
Mm-hmm.
They killed Biggie Smalls. And if you do a very, very critiqued analyzation of the birth of a nation, mm-hmm, the main subject line in terms of how they kept white supremacy in place was there was a white guy that was in the he was in the master's quarters while the slaves were out picking cotton, and he says, you watch Birth of a Nation, he says, we'll just use them against, mm-hmm, themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So they've known from day one that the most powerful way to keep and stay in position in this country, which they don't want to let go of, they want you to get out of their way when they're walking in the mall. They want you to get out of their way when they're walking on the corner. I mean, some of this stuff is in their DNA, mm-hmm, like the lady said on the Channel 5 report that they did with Mr. Curry and the leader of the ACLU, I mean, the director for the ACLU of Boston, I forget his name, Rashad Hall, when they did that, and the woman stood up at the end and she said, it's just white privilege.
Mm-hmm.
It's in our DNA. So, see, there's something that's deep in us, that's in our DNA, and we can characterize it as unawareness of self. But we can also characterize something in their DNA, which is white privilege, which means get out of the way, which means you're going to do our cheap labor, which means, you know, you're going to stay in a state of servitude. And if you dare come out of that state of servitude, we'll be rude and prude and shrewd and make you feel uncomfortable and make you want to get out of this country. But what have we learned? Black Americans, African Americans, aren't going anywhere. We're not going anywhere. We have to share this. So it's ironic that we're in a state in a day and time where the internet has leveled the playing field for everything. There's a lot of people going crazy because they're losing their position because of the internet. So I don't know, in terms of your question, I don't know if it should be one person, because if it is one person, they'll take them out right. using us.
Right. Hmm. Well, and I don't have the answer for that either, but my concern is, when I was growing up in this town, I'm 68, when there were major issues or a crisis in the town, a woman by the name of Melnia Cass, a senior, would speak and call people to the table, and people would show up out of respect for her. She would speak and they would show up. I can remember years ago when Mel King was much younger, when he spoke, people would show up. They would speak. Melnia Cass died, natural causes. Mel King has aged. And he's still with us, but he can't really speak to these issues the way that he used to. I'm just looking at some of the biblical examples, and when as I look in the scripture, I see that God raised up a man, or God raised up a woman for such a time as now to speak to an issue. And so if we don't have a person that's raised up, because the government can always raise up a person, and usually does, or the government can always infiltrate. That's why this new ministerial group that we're going to start, I said no infiltrators need to apply. It's going to be a very small, tight-knit group. We're hoping that our organization is going to be able to at least speak with one voice and address an issue. So are you saying that you don't see it coming from one person? And if it doesn't come from one person, how and where is it going to come from?
Oh, in my opinion, like I said, I don't know. I mean, I think the one person that stands up, you have, you know, they have a great risk of being taken out, not only by their own people, but, you know, by the system of white supremacy. Also, I think that the internet, in terms of raising the level of awareness and the way that we receive information, they had a bunch of big wigs from the IT community in San Jose that were just expressing to a lot of people that were investing in stocks that, yes, this is the next level. And they were also saying that marijuana is the next level. So these people are flooding their money right now. The people that have money are flooding their money into social media development and marketing and marijuana. America wants to be the leading country when it comes to marijuana distribution. I don't know. You know, that's why I'm following you, Pastor Hall. I'm looking for you for some answers.
Well, the other question is, do you think that if we continue to speak the way that we're speaking and giving people a forum on this radio station to speak the way that many people are speaking when they're here, that this radio station will be threatened?
I would definitely say that living in Boston, no, I would say no, because everybody that's associated with your radio station are very conservative, articulate, educated black people, and they're not gonna come at you guys in any type of way. So I would say keep going, keep pushing. And we need more people to stop being scared and stop trying to shun away from you and running to white supremacist nepotism type of people and come back and bring exposure to what's going on in the black community in Boston, because, you know, I did some time. And It is unbelievable the way that these problems. And, you know, you got to give, you know, European Americans some credit, because when they deal with uneducated, unaware young black youth, they deal with a level of rage. So some of the things that they do have merit, because a lot of the young brothers don't know how to articulate themselves and speak to these people. And you're a professional, Pastor Wall. I'm sure you know that when someone comes at you and speaks to you a certain way, it's a turnoff. So when these prosecutors and these judges have these young brothers that have no understanding of the law, and you know, their favorite phrase is ignorance of the law is no excuse, And these brothers are coming in there, you, boom, 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 even calling them white niggers, and just going off with their pants down, blowing kisses at their girlfriend in the behind them, you know, while they're in court. You know, their level of awareness is off, and that's why people like you are needed, because we need to target our youth, we need to target our brothers, we need to, and the resources are here. I mean, LeBron James is doing a bunch of stuff in Cleveland. I mean, Boston, the reason why they want us to believe that there are no resources is so that they can keep the system of white supremacy in place. The money is here. You know, I mean, we got more. I'm sure if we could get in contact with some Celtics players and some NFL players, and they would allocate resources, because they got to share this city with us, and they don't want to go out to these clubs and have to deal with what Paul Pierce went through when he wanted to go out and hang out. So, I'm actually taking some online courses, so let me get back to my courses.
Well, I appreciate you calling in, and I appreciate your perspective. It's been refreshing and very good. Thank you.
Thanks, bro.
617-282-0685. We actually have a number of people who are listening to us tonight on Facebook and also on our chat. They're watching us on our chat. And Denise Reed is watching, and Mary Curry is still talking here. She has a lot of comments that she's making on Facebook Live, and she's agreeing with a lot that she's actually hearing. And we have Overseer Rosalind Young said, yes, we do need a change with the ministerial group here in the city of Boston. 617-282-0685. If you have the courage to pick up the phone and give us a call, we would love to hear from you. Now, I have a group of people here, so I really do not know who this was. Maybe, well, the name says Ronald. No, do we need a new ministerial group in Boston? They say no. We just need to get on the same page in the Word of God, and so that's a response. And I'm still looking for more responses. 617-282-0685 is our telephone number. And Pastor Hobbs, we have less than 15 minutes to go.
Well, I wanted to just interject, because I think one thing that's really important is in the context of our brother's talking about, Richard Eric White talking about this taking courses and the access that we have to technology, and how bridging that whole digital divide is threatening, because it's the information, information highway age. But with that said, I heard some posting something to the effect of, though it's the information, there's plenty of information, there's little wisdom, right? And so, but aside of that, with these TPP, this Trans Pacific Partnership, that thing, man, is really scary, because what that is this, small association of folks who want to, it's going to create a one world banking system, and it's going to ultimately supersede the sovereignty that happens in states and even nations. And so the internet and this information that we have access to, there's a movement to be able to take that away from us. And so it's so important that we really understand and that we're awakened, seize this opportunity of having this information to mobilize, to organize, because there's an aggressive movement to be able to move us, as Reverend Payne said, to this de facto democracy as we know it, to be able to ultimately obliterate that. And so, so it's so important that people really understand in the context of voting, because the powers that be that are ultimately working behind the scenes and trying to do during this whole lame duck time, but we're focusing on, Hillary or Donald Trump, that, and President Obama will be moving out, that they want to just, this legislation is already on the table to be pushed through while we're distracted looking at something else that ultimately is going to have implications that really is going to ultimately remove the democracy as we know it, that clearly is not even full democracy. So I just think that it's so important that people, that thing just really continues to I don't even know the word, to scare me. You know,
I was going
to
just say, I know you're not going to use the word scare.
it's sobering. I want to say scare in a way that is it is scary. It's very, very, very scary. It should be very sobering, and it should be very disturbing. And that scared not to a place that we know that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but there's things that we should fear and walk and confront that fear and work through it, because being in denial is only going to make it ultimate. It isn't going to remove the fact that it's still happening. And so I think there's things that we should fear and we should confront and walk through those fears.
I think that the fear there, what it means for me, I don't know what it means for anybody else, yeah, but it means for me, fear from that perspective is more of respect.
Yes, yes.
I'm not afraid of you. Like, the spirit of fear,
yes,
is not on well me. Said. I have faith to say we that can I respect this. That thing.
Yes,
because I've got to gear up. I've got to get ready to deal with this. I can do it, but I better know. I better respect it if I'm going to be able to address it.
Absolutely. Well said. Well said. So that's something I think that we need to continue to educate ourselves. And again, I'm not hearing that anyplace else. I have not heard that anyplace but here on Boston Praise Radio and TV Network. And the more that I hear it, you know, the more that it just makes sense. First of all, it's Bible prophecy coming to fulfillment. We understand the Antichrist. We understand the one world banking system. But to see it manifesting and to see that, okay, we know Bible prophecy, so we're not caught off guard, but we see this happening, and how do we recognize the sign of the times and what we, the church, have got to do?
And I think I know what the church needs to do. The question for me, is the church in Boston able to make a turn? Mm. That's my question. I think the church in Boston has been working hand in hand, yep, the meetings downtown at City Hall, yep, waiting for the money to be given out to the clergy. I just don't think that our clergy are ready to make that turn.
Well, you know, Pastor, again, we talked
about this. Or if they know they need to make it.
We talked about this a little bit before. So maybe they don't. And maybe some people are caught up and they don't know. Other people maybe do know. And then there may be some people who don't know of any alternative or any option. And they need an option. They need an alternative. They need something to supplement what is already going on. I keep wanting to go back to the 10-point coalition. And you have a better history of that than I do, being, you know, but my understanding is, you know, how that was birthed and how that the impact of that. And I think I've heard you say some of the grassroots kinds of things that happened that they just kind of took the credit for, which is often what happens is this co-opting of a real grassroots movement.
And that's what kills a movement.
Yes.
Is when architect or people come around it and try to take something that was not born out of their vision, was not born out of their work.
Yes.
And they basically take it and try to further develop it, and they can't do it. It no. dies right in their hands. Yes. And that's virtually what has happened. And then people have utilized money,
yes,
as a way of still faking out like the baby was still alive, but the baby was dead.
And so with that said, having that history and understanding that what's happened, what happens in general and what happens specifically here in the city of Boston on so many different occasions, on so many different issues, I think it's so important that, again, this group that we're forming learns from that and doesn't get, you know, sucked into that, for lack of better words.
And I think there's no guarantee that we won't, but I think one way that we can avoid it is by being very careful who you let into your community. Amen. Because this is not a public organization. It is not an organization that's taking money as a nonprofit organization. So you don't need a board of directors. You don't need bylaws. All you need is a mission statement, a vision statement, some core values, and that charts people moving. And the smaller the group, the better it is to manage the group. Yep. And the group doesn't have to be large. The group just needs to be potent.
That's it.
And if the group can challenge the NAACP and the Urban League and other groups in the city of Boston, the Black Ministerial Alliance and other groups to come alongside, then you don't need to grow your group to 30, 40, or 50 people because you've been able to motivate. And so that's what I'm hoping will happen.
Amen. And I think the other thing, Pastor, is I love what Evangelist Mary Curry said, and I think, you know, the thing of having intercessors and us, obviously, you know, bathing this and in prayer, because, you know, obviously anything that's going to really be able to have the implications, you know, that we're looking for, the impact that we're looking for it to ultimately be able to have, it's going to have to be one that we're really are utilizing the principle of collective spiritual warfare and prayer.
I am complete. I am in full agreement with you, and we need to pull the team together to find out if the five people that I have asked to be a part of this really want to do this.
Amen.
And it, as I said, I'm very serious about that. The group identifies a small number of issues to address and addresses them and then moves off the scene until something else major happens. But all of us have organizations that are functioning and dealing with issues. But I think we only need to come together for those issues that need our collective support. It needs our collective prayers. Amen. It just needs us all together. And then when we're not doing that, we go back to the other work that we're doing. Because we're still
building.
It's not like we're not doing anything.
Right. I think that's really critical. And I think that, and we're talking about movement-minded individuals, you know, that as God's given. And again, the visions have been birthed out of anointing, have been birthed out of, you know, relationship with Christ. It's not, you know, it's one thing quite candidly when you're just talking about you know, organization that you got EDs and you got funders and you got members and you got all that kind of stuff, and I guess that has its role, but there's something about, you know, grassroots ministry visionaries that have, that are just saying, you know, that are being birthed out of a unique calling and an anointing to be able to do what God has called them to do. It's really paradigm shift in terms of systems. That's not just about how do we be parts of systems and get a piece of the pie, but how do we do a paradigm shift that really is about, you know, restructuring the whole notion of what a pie even is, I guess.
617-282-0685. Pastor Hobbs and I are winding down this broadcast. We've been here broadcasting since 9 o'clock tonight, and we're hoping that we can actually wind this down with some final summary thoughts before we call it quits. I've actually been in the studio since 5:30 this morning. I've been broadcasting since 6 a.m. and I am exhausted. Caller, go ahead. You're live on the air.
Good evening, gentlemen. I'm listening to your broadcast, and it's been wonderful, and I also am pleased to participate in the ventures, what you guys have to put together. I love the concept, I love the idea, and I love the fact that, you know, we can get together and try to really get some things accomplished in a different way. I'm not really so happy with, to be honest with you, another organization, but I mean, we got to keep, I'm believing that you got to swing at everything that, you know, until you get the home run, and I think that we can put together a team of people that can hit the home run. But I have another thing that's on my spirit, and it's really troubling me, that I hope you guys can help me with. It's not such a pleasant one, but let's start with abortion and period. I want you to, and I know that you yourself, and even I'd like to ask someone who does research, like Jamal Crawford, if he's listening, to sort of help me out with this. I believe I've been doing a little research and find out that the number one killer of black people is abortion. And that's even before they before they exit the womb. I mean, we're killing, we have more black people being killed. And so I sort of kind of connected this to, I left you to do research and also find out what was President Obama's first act. I want you to help me to understand his first act, because I believe it had to do with abortion. I may be wrong, but this is just something I want to put out there. I know this is not a pleasant one, but it's just something that's troubling me right now, and I need some help with it. So if you guys could take that off of me and think about it and get back to me on it, I'm really troubled, because it's really something that I'm looking at, and I'm trying to really get a firm understanding of what I'm seeing. I want to influence someone, but I want to hear you guys' opinion and what you think it means, and it's, and why he did what he did, if he did what he did. So I just want to leave it at that.
Well, I appreciate you staying up with us as we have been on the air and pushing for hours now. And many times when I'm in my automobile, I just long to be able to just turn the radio on and listen to this, what you just said, to listen to what we've been talking about. Not that I want to participate. I just want to hear it. I just want my mind stimulated. I just want to know that there's somebody else in this town who is not believing the hype, is not accepting everything as it's perceived to be. And even a question like the question you just asked us is an important question. I think you have the answer. I think you're asking the question because you want us to be able to do some research so that we can find the same answer out that you found. But then the question is going to be, what are we going to do about it?
Yes, 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 Pastor. You know, a man with vision is clear. And you're right. I'm hoping that I'm in this case, Pastor, I'm hoping that I'm wrong. That's why I need the help of my brothers and my people, you know, to really straighten me out and explain to me what they see or what they understand. But, you know, we got to move on and go on anyway, you know, and we're going to do what we got to do. And I think it's so important that we formulate this group and really shake some trees.
Okay, I don't know why you used that last sentence and that last word in your sentence, but you did. Did you hear what you said?
Yeah. Yes.
You said we need to shake some trees. There's only one tree that we need to shake. And I also want to tell you that.
I should have known I wasn't going to get away with being serious.
No, listen. We actually had the driveway at our church repaved. And
yep.
We have a dumpster that they were going to put down on the new asphalt, and every time the truck comes to empty it, it picks it up, then it bang, it comes down. So I said, you need to move that dumpster on dirt and get it off of the brand new asphalt. But there was a big tree that was actually right next to the church window, and I told the church, I'm cutting it down. I'm not asking for permission. I'm cutting it down. So before I could even, I got my little power saw that I got at Home Depot. I was so
proud. Oh, yeah, I'm going to tell you about it.
I have pruning blades, large ones and small ones. I popped that bad boy on and pressed that button, and I'm going to town. So I went and got my little thing, and I was going to timber in front of my church. And when I got here, the two guys in the church had already been here, and they took it down. So that's because I wanted to show you what I could do.
Well, God was looking out for you, Pastor. He didn't want you to show me what you could do.
Thank you for calling in, sir.
Thank you, sir. You tell him to have a good night.
Okay, bye bye. You know, that's funny. I didn't know that was Brother Lowe.
I didn't know at first either.
Because his voice was different.
Yes.
And I didn't catch it until 3 quarters. It took me 3 quarters of the way to get through to know that that was Brother Law.
7 minutes. If, too.
Now I should have known it was him because of the phone. There was something wrong with the phone, right? It just wasn't clear.
Yes.
And I think that's because he doesn't use Verizon or Sprint.
There we go.
I think he uses some other startup cell phone company. And it's okay. It's okay. We need to save money. Well, Pastor Hobbs, it's 11:59, and I think that's about it for the night. I don't think we can go any longer. I think that are there any other? You know, when people make the comments,
yes.
How do we go and read all the comments? Because each time they make a comment, it goes further down on the screen. Then we lose it, right?
Yeah.
So Mary Alice Curry says, because the Lord is leading me to listen to this conversing that we have been needing for a long time. Because I asked, why is she still up? Mm-hmm. You two have always been two of my favorite mentors. Uh-huh. Amen. Dr. Pina, A.M. with you.
Oh, wow.
We must connect, sister. And Richard says, we can't trust whitewash statistics, census bureaus, and I agree with him. Mm-hmm. But how do we get to the other comments that people have made? I can't figure that out. I want to be able to see it, but I'm sure they have got to have something here.
There has to be a way. Yeah, I'm trying to figure it out as well. We
hide from town, delete, turn on, trans. There's got to be a way that
to
you
get
can.
The whole.
Yeah, this is.
Yeah, so you. I was having the same problem.
So I was hoping you told me.
I'm trying to figure that out.
Maybe Brother Lowe's going to have to help us how to do this. We had quite a few people that have commented here, but I can't read all their comments. Well, we'll have to work on this. We'll have to talk to our Facebook experts and they'll have to teach us. We're going to close out because I've got to go home and get some sleep and get up at 4 o'clock and come back here and start this all over again on tomorrow. Why are you looking at me like that? You're gonna be back here tomorrow to do your broadcast.
Yes, I do.
So Pastor Hobbs and I want to say, there's some more comments here. So Kyle says exactly. Mary says Osama bin Laden. And then she says people can be trees, bold pastor, and because we can't see what they're talking about, we don't understand the context of what they're talking about. That's amazing. Okay. And I had asked Denise why she was still up, but I can't see her comment because it's hidden with all the other comments.
Richard says, come out of full screen to see all in the list.
Come out of full screen?
Come out of full screen. I don't know if I'm reading that wrong. Okay. Then he says later, come out of full screen.
And he's saying that on Facebook?
He's saying it on the Facebook feed.
I don't see it. I see the last thing I see is bold pastor for Mary Alice Curry. You got more than that?
Yeah, I have It's Okay. Come out full screen, fast reading, and then again come out of full screen. So I don't know if you, and that's actually if I scrolled down on your page, not the first post, but the second post of the live feed. That's where I'm seeing.
Well, I think that Richard's going to have to come to the studio tonight.
Yes.
And he's going to have to come all the way to the studio.
We'll
stay here and we'll wait. And he's going to have to give us the insight as to how to do this because this is.
Osprin, she communicated something. She says, and she's in the instant chat room on Facebook. She says, I mean, not on Facebook, on Boston Praise
Radio.
She
better not know how to do it, and I don't know how to do it.
No. She's talking about Brother Lowe's comment about the president's first act. She's giving us some educational information. She says, I think President Obama's first act was to become president. She says, a black man in the White House. She says, that has really got up the noses of the white supremacist. Everything that has transpired reflects this amazing fact. The lie has been exposed. Babylon is falling according to the biblical prophecy. Hallelujah.
That's what she said?
Yeah. I thought she was going to say some about this act beyond that act, but interesting that we got to still got to do some research with regard to what Brother Lowe's referring to.
Right, and okay, I appreciate that. And Richard says, "Come out of full screen."
Yeah.
I don't know. Because I want to hear what people are saying here.
Yeah, you got to hear.
I want to get out of here, but I also want to hear what they're saying.
Right.
And when it gets late like this, then you begin to say stupid things. So,
yeah. Come out of full screen. See all of them. I think he's saying. I don't know. We need a console, Brother Wright, White. Richard Eric White.
Right. So, okay. So we'll stay here until he takes the MBTA. Do you know that they're actually going to start a late night MBTA ride, and they're hiring another company to do it here in the city of Boston? So he'll be able to. There are still people in here. Angela Rivera is also in here.
Yes.
Commenting.
Yes.
And I believe in just a few moments that Facebook Live is actually going to go offline.
Okay.
Okay, so someone says, Angela says, she says, seasoned and sold out to the Lord is the only way to combat the concerns we have in this world. If we open up and surrender our free will to God, he will not steer us wrong. Prayer and persistence brings about the change. We must be on one accord.
Amen.
Okie dokie. All right, well, we want to thank each and every one of you for being live with us. We're going to go out now with a station ID, and Pastor Hobbs is going to